Good evening, everyone. I'm Rabbi Julia Andelman, Director of Community Engagement at JTS, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the Jack and Lewis Rudin Lecture. In addition to welcoming everyone here in the room, I'm really pleased to welcome our live stream viewers joining us from across North America, and we're really happy to be able to share tonight's program with you. At this time, let me remind everyone here in the room to please silence your cell phones. Thank you. The Jack and Lewis Rudin Lectures at JTS provide the opportunity for eminent academics, religious leaders, intellectuals, and public figures to discuss topics of interest with the JTS community and the public at large. And we're very grateful to the Rudin family for sponsoring the Rudin Lecture Series. Our topic this evening, ripped from the headlines, is the U.S. healthcare system, what does the future hold? Classical Jewish legal sources are clear on the centrality and necessity of healthcare. Individuals are mandated to seek medical care if they're ill, rather than relying on divine miracles for their healing. Halacha, Jewish law, also mandates that medical professionals must be paid for their work. And finally, it's incumbent upon communities to provide for the medical care of those who can't afford it. In the words of the Tzitz Eliezer, perhaps the most prominent 20th century halachic scholar on medical issues, it has been enacted that in every place in which Jews live, the community sets aside a fund for care of the sick. When poor people are ill and cannot afford medical expense, the community sends them a doctor to visit them, and the medicine is paid for by the communal fund. Similarly, the Committee on Jewish Law and Standards, which is the halachic body of the conservative movement, has ruled that, quote, the community bears ultimate responsibility to assure provision of needed health care for individuals who cannot afford it as a matter of justice as well as a specific halachic obligation. And yet, while Jewish law and Jewish values are unambiguous in expecting society to provide health care for anyone who needs it, translating those principles into an organized and solvent system of medical care for 325-odd million people is obviously another matter altogether. As we know, debates are raging in the halls of Congress, the White House, state and municipal governments, town hall meetings, hospitals, insurance companies, doctor's offices, and homes across America. What are the unique challenges of healthcare reform in the U.S.? Why does the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, look as it does? Are there alternative plans that could achieve the same gains? And what are the political prospects of those alternatives? So here this evening to shed light on the past, present, and possible future of healthcare reform in America is prominent health policy expert, Dr. Sherry Glied. Dr. Glied is Dean of New York University's Robert F. Wagner Graduate School of Public Service. She was previously Professor of Health Policy and Management at Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health, and she also served as Chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management there. Under Presidents George H.W. Bush and Bill Clinton, Dr. Glied served as Senior Economist for Healthcare and Labor Market Policy on the President's Council of Economic Advisors, and she participated in the Clinton Healthcare Task Force. In 2010, under President Barack Obama, she was confirmed by the U.S. Senate as Assistant Secretary for Planning and Evaluation at the Department of Health and Human Services, and she served in that capacity for 2 years. Dr. Glied's principal areas of research are in health policy reform and mental health care policy. She has written Chronic Condition about healthcare reform and co-authored with Richard Frank, Better But Not Well, Mental Health Policy in the U.S. since 1950. She holds a PhD in economics from Harvard University, and on top of all that, she is my former congregant from my days in the pulpit, and I can tell you every rabbi should only wish for congregants like Sherry and her family. We're so pleased to welcome you, Dr. Sherry Glied, to JTS. Let me invite you to the podium.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Andelman, and thank you, all of you. I'm deeply honored to be speaking, especially here. It's actually a kind of meaningful experience for me in a weird and attenuated way. One of my mentors at Columbia was Professor Eli Ginsberg. Eli was a very cheerful, but deeply pessimistic man. He served 8 presidents from Roosevelt through Carter, and he taught for us at the Department of Health Policy and Management. He was a paragon to faculty everywhere. He died at the age of 91 after grading the last of the final exams of his students. When the ACA passed, my first recollection was thinking how surprised Eli would have been that we actually got to health reform in America. But in this context, Eli was the son of Professor Louis Ginsberg, who was for a long time, taught Talmud at JTS for over 50 years. So in some way, I am almost like a grandchild of the seminary, in a very attenuated way, but to the task at hand. Rabbi Andelman contacted me about giving this lecture back in December. And a lot has happened in the 10 weeks since that phone call. It has truly been a policy roller coaster on so many fronts, and healthcare not least among them. So it's a little hard if you're a lecturer to give a lecture when every single day things are changing underfoot. And in order to kind of avoid that problem, what I want to do is give you some context, a little bit of history, and some ideas about what to look for as the debate proceeds, what questions you might ask yourself as we go forward. So I want to start off by actually suggesting that healthcare is a relatively new problem and when we think about social welfare policy. Now, the Torah talks about infectious diseases, tzaraat. It talks about disability. King Saul is reported to have had epilepsy. When we look at the secular history of medicine, we start with Hippocrates. He wrote in 500 or so BC. And Galen, the Roman, wrote in about 200 AD. And the first important physician in Jewish thought is Rambam, who was the court physician to the court of Saladin in the 12th century. Rambam actually complained about medical practice in many of the same ways that doctors today complain. He noted that people seek medical help from anyone whom they meet by chance and from everything which seems new. And sometimes a patient is being attended by 10 physicians according to his means without one knowing of the other. The patient then takes the advice of each of the doctors, makes his decision, and chooses what he finds good by his own judgment. One can easily imagine reading that in the pages of JAMA today. But all these writers, including Rambam, were really focused on a particular aspect of healthcare, which is the relationship between an expert physician and a vulnerable patient. So it was a very binary kind of relationship. And even when they thought about the social interest in healthcare, they were mostly worried about care for the indigent, for those dying, really a kind of palliative function of the healthcare system. That whole way of thinking about medicine, which remains with us, and which is actually an important consideration in medical policy today, that relationship between the patient and the physician, changed a lot around the time of the turn of the 20th century. And it changed for two reasons. One was the development of industrialization. The economy changed, and people were no longer living on farms and in villages where people could take care of them when they were sick in a very natural way, but they were living in a place where the aged and the disabled and the infirm could no longer work and bring home wages from factories. And that actually is a reason that Bismarck, for example, began universal health insurance in Germany in the late 19th century. The second reason, and one that remains with us very importantly today, was changes in medical care. Lawrence Henderson, who was a biochemist at Harvard, did the first calculations of this, and he looked back in the 1950s and said, I think it was about the year 1910 or 1912 when it became possible to say of the United States that a random patient with a random disease consulting a doctor chosen at random stood better than a 50-50 chance of benefiting from the encounter. Now just think about that in the history that I told you. Right? Medicine dates back to 500 BC or longer, but for most of that time, it didn't do anybody any good on average. So only at the beginning of the 20th century that we move towards a medical care system that can actually do more for people. And that accelerated very rapidly, especially with the development of sulfa drugs in the 1930s, which made surgery actually a treatment that you might actually be willing to accept because you weren't going to die of infection immediately afterward. To give you a sense of how important those developments in medical care were, and to put everything in context as we go forward. In 1999, life expectancy at birth in India was about 60 years. In 1820, life expectancy in birth in England was about 40 years, but those two places had the same income. So income in India in 1999 was comparable to income in the United Kingdom in 1820, but life expectancy was 20 years longer. That is, we just got much better at treating people. And we know this from our own, from Jewish thought too, because if you read Tehillim, it says the days of our years are among them are 70 years, and if we are very mighty, then 80 years. But today, more than 3/4 of babies can expect to live to the age of 70, and more than half to the age of 80. So medical care has definitely changed since Torah times. That means that we can do more for people. We want them to get care in a very different way. And by the 1920s, people writing about healthcare, people thinking about healthcare in the United States, began to be concerned over the high cost of medical care and whether families could actually afford the care that they needed. This was the moment when people with health conditions actually could incur costs and yet survive. So up until that point, it might incur costs, but it probably wasn't going to do you any good. Now we get to the point where you incur costs and you survive. Galen described diabetes in 200. In Rome, there was the incidence of diabetes, and Galen recognized it. In 1922, Banting and Best developed insulin. And we start to have chronic conditions that people survive with. People live with diabetes and survive cancer and heart disease. The first of what we might call today pre-existing conditions. So the whole idea of a pre-existing condition, this problem that we're now facing in reforming our healthcare system, is a problem that doesn't even exist until about the 1920s. So let me start to think about where we go from here with three fundamental observations that really constitute the paradox of healthcare. Improvements in technology over time make healthcare more valuable, but they also drive up costs. So because we are doing better for people, it costs us more to do it. We do more for more people for a longer time, and that means that average health spending rises more rapidly than incomes do. Average spending rises as a share of national income. We now stand at about 17% of the GDP. So average spending rises. Average spending rises is one problem that comes about because of improving technology. But the second problem is that in any year, only a tiny fraction of the population gets sick. It's always true. If that had not been true, and you remember the statistics I just quoted to you, the human race would have become defunct. Only a small number of people can actually get sick in an era when we can't cure them. 1% of all people in any population, it would be true even in this room, account for roughly 25% of all healthcare costs in a given year. That's true today. It was true since about the 1930s when we began measuring this. Today, if you are in that 1%, you are likely to incur costs of more than $85,000 in that year. Now, against that 1% who account for 25% of all costs are the 50% of health spenders who spend almost nothing on healthcare and account for only 3% of costs. Today, that 50% spends on average less than $250 a year. So we have this composition of a population in which if you're unlucky and you get really sick, you're going to incur these tremendously high costs, but if you're fortunate and you're in that healthy 50% of the population, you will spend almost nothing. Now, those very high costs that occur among the top 1% are so high relative to people's incomes that saving and borrowing for the cost of medical care is no longer a practical solution. You can't get away with having enough money in your piggy bank to deal with the potential that you might have something terribly wrong with you. And then that generates a need for new institutions and new policies. And those new institutions and new policies have to address four fundamental challenges. First, they need a mechanism to pool risk. So they have to put together people, they have to address both unexpected illnesses, things that you don't know about when you buy your care, and they have to address the chronically ill, those with those pre-existing conditions. So first, we need a mechanism that pools together the healthy and the sick. Second, we need a mechanism that shares costs between the rich and the poor, because even the average cost at 17% of GDP is too high for many people to be able to afford to pay. So we're going to need some mechanism that redistributes money from the rich to the poor. And third, we need a mechanism that will accommodate changes in spending over time. And this is actually a very tricky one that Washington doesn't like to grapple with. Changes in spending over time as technologies improve. Because every time technologies improve, we want to use them, they're good for us, we're going to wind up spending more money. And then on top of those, we need mechanisms for cost containment too, because otherwise the system is going to get out of hand. The growth of models, different ways to address these four challenges, happened across the high-income nations over the period from about 1930 to 1970. So if you look across all the high-income nations, Germany, England, France, Sweden, Canada, whatever, you look at all these countries, people came up with many different models to address these four challenges. There's tremendous variation among them, but they all try and meet those four sets of needs. In the United States, Roosevelt sidestepped the issue when Social Security came in. He decided healthcare is just too much bother, I don't want to go there. Truman tried and failed. And then we get to about the 1960s. Over this period, while other countries are developing their healthcare systems, in the United States, employer-sponsored insurance begins to grow. It really takes off. In 1945, 25 million Americans were covered by health insurance through their jobs. 20 years later, 140 million were covered. By 1965, 70% of the population held health insurance through their employers. Johnson, in 1965, part of his Great Society, fills in some key gaps. He introduces the Medicare program to cover people 65 and over. He builds up Medicaid to buttress existing state programs for the deserving poor, for widows and orphans, and those with work-limiting disabilities. There's more care available. There's more resources available to pay for it. We're spending more money. But it's worth it. We observe substantial gains in life expectancy and reductions in disability across the population as we expand the reach of medical care. But healthcare costs begin to rise. For a long period, they had stayed at around 4% of GDP. Beginning in the 1960s, they start to escalate. And because Medicare and Medicaid are federal programs, federal costs for healthcare begin to rise, and people begin to worry about what is this big government system about to do to us. Okay, so at the end of the 1960s, we have the elderly covered, some very poor people covered, and employer-sponsored insurance reaching many but not all of the rest. There are two more attempts at universal health insurance. Does anyone know who the first one was after Johnson? I know I shouldn't do this because I'm being live streamed, but I'll repeat whatever you say. It was Nixon, Richard Nixon. So it was a Republican who actually strove to get universal health insurance. His family, his younger brother had tuberculosis, so he had a real experience of the cost of medical care. He tried and failed, and then Bill Clinton tried and failed. Over this period, we had some expansions of Medicaid to children. We had the introduction of the SCHIP program. And we get to fast forward all the way. I'm going to skip everything all the way to 2008. So you've got a little bit of a framework here, the four challenges that we need to face. Where does the healthcare system stand in 2008, just at the dawn of the Affordable Care Act era? So health insurance in the United States was fragmented into different segments, really into five groups. About half of the population, roughly, has employer-sponsored health insurance. About 15% of the population has Medicare. About 15% of the population is covered by the Medicaid program. About 5% of the population is covered by the non-group insurance market. I'm going to go into all of these in a little more detail in a moment. And about 15% are uninsured. Let's walk through each of those segments of the fragmented U.S. healthcare system at that point. Employer-sponsored insurance works pretty well. People like it. They like having coverage from their jobs. It works well for many reasons. First, it's an employment benefit. It's not the reason that you take your job. Very few people take their job just because of the nature of health insurance that's offered to them. So you get a mix of people collected together for an employer. That's very good for insurance pooling purposes. The employer can also sign you up for coverage. You're right there, you're sitting there, the HR person comes by and signs you up for coverage. It makes it very administratively efficient. Most people stick with their jobs for quite a while, so it's not a lot of churning in this market. Conventionally, and even today, employers pick up about 80% of the tab for the coverage that you buy. And the other 20% is paid the same by everybody. Now, if you ask an economist, and I'm an economist by training, what they will tell you is that 80% is not paid by the employer. Employers never pay anything, right? What does the employer do? The employer reduces your wages, in effect, reduces the compensation package, changes the compensation package, moving some of the compensation into health insurance and some of it into wages. But you as a worker, if you decide not to take the health insurance, you don't get a pay increase, right? So each person doesn't observe that, even if at the employer level it's true. You pay the 20% only. So from your perspective, whether you decide to participate in the health plan or not is simply a function of that 20%. So we have this kind of subsidy provided by the employer, and it's supported by a big subsidy provided by the federal government in the form of what's called the tax exclusion for employer-sponsored health insurance. That is, if your employer pays you your salary in wages, you pay taxes on the wages. If your employer converts that to health insurance, you don't pay taxes on the health insurance. That tax exclusion is not appropriated by the federal government. It's an automatic spending tap. It came to $250 billion in 2016. It's about a 30% discount on your premium, and it comes to almost $1,000 per person insured in the market. So most people getting health insurance in the United States have a de facto subsidy from the federal government through this tax exclusion. So let me go back to those four challenges and think about how employer-sponsored insurance deals with them. redistribution from the healthy to the sick under employer-sponsored insurance? There certainly is. Since people only pay that 20% of premium, there is no reason to drop your coverage just because you're a relatively healthy person. So healthy people band together with much older people, with sicker people, since 20% of the cost of coverage is all they can save if they choose not to participate. There's no underwriting in health in employer-sponsored insurance. Everybody gets the same benefits. The benefits are quite generous. We cover a lot of services. What about redistribution from the richer to the poorer? It's a little bit more mixed up. You could talk about the regressivity of the tax exclusion of employer-sponsored health insurance if you really wanted to, but I'm not going to. If you're sitting in your employer plan, what you observe is a patina of equality, much more than in almost any other respect of the employment relationship. If you go down to JP Morgan and sit by one of the partners there, that partner's secretary has the same health insurance as her boss. So we have a kind of patina of equality that comes out of employer-sponsored health insurance. What about technological change? How does employer-sponsored insurance deal with the fact that healthcare is getting better and more expensive? Because of the open-ended tax exclusion, employers continue to incorporate new technologies in their health plans, and the system is actually able to capture that. And what about containing costs? Employers have a fair number of tools at their disposal to contain costs. They can't regulate prices, but they can do managed care and utilization review and network design and cost sharing and all kinds of other things that nobody likes, but do have the effect of restraining costs. So the employer-sponsored insurance system, whether you like it or not, kind of addresses those four challenges in a pretty successful way, which I think is one of the reasons it's stuck around in the United States for so long. Well, let's look at Medicare, because there is another kind of plan that we have right here in our system. Medicare is federally financed through payroll taxes and general revenues. And now here's a wonky point. It's what's called an entitlement program. So the federal budget is divided among entitlement programs and appropriated programs. Entitlement programs do not require Congress to vote a budget. Whatever the program costs, that's what the federal government pays. An appropriated program is one where the federal government has to actually appropriate money ahead of time. Medicare is an entitlement program. That means it's going to whatever it costs, that's how much money there will be available to pay for it. Eligibility is automatic at age 65, and once you get on Medicare, you stay on Medicare. There are no transitions off of Medicare. That's going to turn out to be important. Beneficiaries pay about 12% of the cost of the program in premiums. 88% of it is subsidized through payroll taxes and general revenue. A lot of people in the program are now in what are called Medicare Advantage plans. We often think about Medicare as being a single-payer plan, a government-run plan. In fact, about 30% of people in Medicare are enrolled in private health plans. And those private health plans are incorporated into Medicare through a system that moves money from plans that enroll primarily healthy people to plans that enroll primarily sick people. So how does Medicare address those four challenges that I started off with? With respect to moving money from the healthy to the sick, there's no underwriting in Medicare. There's this risk adjustment system. There are many mechanisms in Medicare to move money from the healthy to the sick. What about from the rich to the poor? Medicare is an intentionally redistributive program. It is paid for by taxes, so it very explicitly moves money from the rich to the poor. What about new technology? Because it's an entitlement program, when new technologies come along, expenditures rise, those technologies are captured by the program. And what about cost containment? Well, Medicare actually can control prices to some extent, and it also does a lot of innovation in delivery system. So Medicare is another model that actually fits these four challenges. Medicaid is the program that serves both the low-income poor. I want to start off by noting Medicaid is a program that's been around since the 1960s. It started off as a program that, in the words of social welfare analysts in the US, served only what we call the deserving poor. So who are the deserving poor? People who are disabled, mothers with dependent children, the blind, and the elderly. Those were the only groups that were considered to be deserving. Over the course of the 1980s and 90s, eligibility for the program was extended to most poor children. So children became deserving even if their mothers were not single. But in over half the states in the union, if you were a single adult without children, you were not eligible for Medicaid no matter how little money you had. Even if you had absolutely no income whatsoever, you had no eligibility for Medicaid. So Medicaid was a program very much constrained in its eligibility. Does Medicaid meet the goals of the four challenges that we thought about? Yes. It puts everybody in one pool. It moves money from the healthy to the sick. It moves money to the rich to the poor. It's an entitlement program. It grows with technology. And it's actually a very cheap program. So from a cost containment perspective, it works. So you take those three programs together, employer-sponsored insurance, Medicare, and Medicaid. In 2008, that gets you to 80% of the population. 80% of the population that's in a system that pretty much works in terms of the things that we want a system to do. But the remainder, who are not elderly, who are not poor enough, or live in a state that does not extend eligibility, who are not employed in a firm that offers health insurance, what happens to them? Well, one thing to know about this group of people, and this is a thing to think about as Republican plans for health reform progress, is that it's a very highly transient population. This is not a population that is always the same people. These are young adults aging out of their parents' health insurance plans, finding their first jobs. It's older people taking early retirement. It's people who have lost a job or become divorced, people who are going through life changes. Only about half of the people who are in this group are still there a year later. People are moving around a lot. This is a very mobile group. The one place they have to go to get coverage is what we call the non-group insurance market. It's only about 5% of the market in 2008. There are no subsidies at all. Medicaid is subsidized, Medicare is subsidized, employer-sponsored insurance is subsidized through the tax treatment. In this market, there are no subsidies. People who go into it are just buying coverage. They're not making any other decisions. So they're really looking for the coverage that best suits them. The coverage is heavily underwritten, meaning the insurance company looks at your characteristics and prices you health insurance based on what you look like at that moment. What does that mean? Well, we did some analysis at one point of what got you locked out of the individual insurance market. If you were an adolescent with a diagnosis of depression, that was enough to get you completely locked out of the private health insurance market. That pre-existing condition could be enough for you to be denied coverage. Premiums increase with age. Premiums for women are higher than for men. So many respects in which this model, this insurance market, is really tailoring premiums and even packages of coverage to the particular needs of the individual who's buying coverage. There was a system called guaranteed renewability, meaning that once you were in a plan, you could stay in it forever, but the insurance company could raise all the premiums in that plan, and they did. There was continuous coverage in the sense that if you lost employer-sponsored coverage, you were guaranteed to be able to buy a plan in this market, but the insurance company could charge you whatever price it chose. And this market had very high administrative costs. In order for people to get cheap plans, they would go ahead and take very lousy benefits. So there were a lot of plans in this market with $10,000, $15,000 deductibles. Most plans had no maternity care. If you wanted maternity care, you had to pay for an extra rider. Usually it cost $3,000 to $5,000 in case you had a baby that year. Many plans had no substance abuse services or no mental health services. So very narrow plans with very high cost sharing, and in most markets, very few carriers. If we think about the challenges that we want a mechanism to work, to do, none of them really work in this market. There is no transfer from the healthy to the sick because there's underwriting to make sure that everybody's plan is priced to them. There is no transfer from the rich to the poor. Everybody pays their own premium. When technology changes happen, they raise costs and cause more people to drop out of the market. And although there are some elements of cost containment, they mostly consist of getting people to leave the market altogether. There were efforts to bolster this market. They didn't really work out. I want to make one quick digression because we're about to go down the same rabbit hole again. Some states thought maybe they could solve this by regulating the market and requiring that insurance plans sell coverage to all comers, don't underwrite, guaranteed issue, all the good things we would like to see, and New York State was one of them. So what do you think happens when you say, in this individual market where people are shopping for care, you have to cover everybody, you can't charge them more money? Well, what happens is sick people go and get coverage, the premiums start to go up, and the healthy people drop out of the market, and that's what happened in New York. By the time 2008 came along, an individual policy in the New York State health insurance market cost $16,000 a year. There were only 17,000 people in the entire state, 0.1% of the population, remaining in the market. They were all very sick people, people who couldn't afford, who were willing to pay $16,000 for a health insurance policy. In health economics terms, and I see many of my students here, this is called an adverse selection spiral. It's really dreaded. You price based on the average, and everyone who expects costs below the average leaves the market. So trying to solve this with regulations alone just doesn't work. Now, only 5% of that remaining 20% are in the non-group market. The remainder are uninsured in 2008, about 50 million people, 15% of the population. And remember I told you that that's a churning population? 15% of the population is uninsured at a point in time. About 30% of the population in 2008 experienced a spell of uninsurance over the course of a year. So there's a lot of people who are moving in and out of uninsurance. It's a very heterogeneous group. Young people, older retirees, self-employed people, unlucky people. Usually low income, but with incomes above Medicaid. Higher income people were usually working, and if you're working, you're probably getting insurance from your employer. Many have health conditions, 25 to 50%, depending on the measure. So this is a system that is not working out very well. In the election of 2008, the question comes up, what should we do about this? Is there actually a social responsibility to address problems of technologically driven cost growth, to redistribute services from the healthy to the sick, to redistribute from the rich to the poor? Is there actually a social responsibility to do that? Well, Rabbi Andelman started off by saying she says that Jewish sources say there are, and I'm gonna try and build on that for a moment. But I wanna suggest, first of all, that not everybody believes there is such a responsibility. And there are different views for why there is not. And since we're in a different administration now, it's probably worth thinking about why people might think there is no such social responsibility. So one group of people who think there is no such social responsibility are fiscal conservatives. Paul Ryan is a great example of such a person. Ryan and his colleagues believe that healthcare spending is putting a strain on the federal budget that can't be accepted, especially as the baby boom gets older. These are open-ended entitlement programs. They mean that government is gonna grow, taxes are gonna have to go up, and that's just not an acceptable outcome for a fiscal conservative. So one group of people who don't believe there's such a social responsibility are fiscal conservatives. There's a second group of people who I would call libertarian anti-redistributionists. Maybe Rand Paul is a good example of that. They just say, look, property rights are what is important. What's yours is yours. Redistribution generates perverse incentives. We want everyone to work. People should take care of themselves. So there's that second position. There's a third group of people, and I couldn't find the right person for it, but I've definitely heard this and I see it on conservative websites, but I didn't want to quote them, that says illness is fate. What we really want is to give people incentives to stay healthy, to have skin in the game. If you eat right and you don't smoke, why should you pay more because there are obese, lazy smokers out there? Okay? We have to give people every incentive to take care of themselves, and any way that we move money around is gonna take that incentive away. And then there's also a group of people who I think, many of them very religious people, who believe that this is that caring for the poor is an individual responsibility and not a collective responsibility. That the right way to deal with a social problem like this is through voluntary charity and not through a government program. So there is a group of people, many of them deeply moral, I think, but with this view that actually this should be a matter of voluntary charity. Now, Rabbi Andelman asked me when she invited me to do this, that I should speak a little bit about this topic from a Jewish perspective. And as I was thinking about this, I realized that I was a student of the wrong Professor Ginsburg to be doing this. But I will try a little bit and just give you a little bit of my sense of how we could think about this from a Jewish perspective. And I am, because Rabbi Andelman was our rabbi for many years, I learned this from her that, you know, you can always try and take something out of the Parshat HaShavua if you work at it hard enough. And we're actually at a very good moment for this because we're about to read Mishpatim. Mishpatim is kind of the moment in the Torah, Yitro and Mishpatim, where we move from fate and God and things coming down from heaven to how people are going to deal with each other. And that's really the theme of the Parsha. And one of the pieces in Mishpatim is the laws governing relations among people. And it says, if you lend my people money, the poor man with you, you shall not behave toward him as a creditor. So that's this Parsha. Nechama Leibowitz, in interpreting this Parsha, points out, citing Rambam, that lending to the poor is a duty or an obligation. It's much more important than giving charity. It's a distinctive thing. It's not the same thing as charity at all. It's actually a duty or obligation. My colleague and friend Sam Fleischacker, who has written a philosophical work about this, extends this idea to say that our obligations to the poor arise from justice and not from charity. These are two different avenues of thinking about where obligations arise from, and here we're talking about an obligation of justice. This distinction between justice and charity, I think, really emphasizes the need for us to recognize the autonomy and the dignity of those who seek our help, and encourages us to help them in ways that enhance that autonomy. Not only is this obligation set forth, but Rambam suggests that it's not for us to question why someone is hungry or needs our help. He writes, "If a poor man unknown to anyone comes forth and says, 'I am hungry, give me something to eat,' he should not be examined as to whether he might be an imposter. He should be fed." So we don't want to think about what the incentive effects of our policies are going to be so much. We really want to provide people with the services. And in Talmud Yerushalmi, there's this great story. Samuel fled from his father. He went along and arrived between two poor houses. He overheard the poor people say, "On which table service shall we eat today? The gold service or the silver service?" And Samuel came back and told all this to his father. His father said, "We must act charitably even towards those among the poor who are deceivers. Even if people are not actually poor and they're just pretending to be poor, because if it were not for the deceivers, if a person was asked for charity and did not immediately extend it, he would immediately perish as punishment." So we have to, we ought not to be thinking about why people need care, why people need these resources. This is, I think, what in congressional language would be called an entitlement. So I wouldn't want to go so far as to say that the Torah says that this should be an entitlement and not an appropriation. I don't think that that would be a fair reading of rabbinic language, but this language of obligation and entitlement is very much there. And actually, even the question of what happens when the cost of doing so becomes ever more expensive is actually something that, of course, not in this context, the sages address, and Rambam has an answer to it. He says, "One is commanded to give to a poor person according to what he lacks. If he has no clothes, they clothe him." And he continues, "Even if it was the custom of a person who was once rich but is now poor to ride on a horse with a servant running in front of him, and this is a person who fell from his station, they buy him a horse to ride upon and a servant to run in front of him, as it is said, sufficient for whatever he needs." That is, as things change, as people's circumstances change, our obligations to them have to do with their needs and what resources we have available to us. So I don't want to make too much of this. I'm not a rabbinic scholar by any means, but I would say as an economist, that's how the way that we talk about evidence is that, or theory and data, is that something is consistent with the evidence. And here I would say that Jewish thought is consistent with the idea that we do have an obligation to meet these four challenges, that we do have a social obligation. So let me turn back to things I'm more comfortable with and talk about what happened in 2008. In health reform in 2008 was not only a momentous step, but it was really a politically tortured one. Remember, Johnson and Roosevelt had decided against going for universal coverage. Truman, Nixon, Clinton had all failed to get universal coverage bills through. When Obama was elected, the Republicans signaled very early that they would not support any move towards universal health insurance. So that came very, very early along. There was only a very brief window from the election of Al Franken in Minnesota by 312 votes in July of 2009, that the Democrats, in combination with independents Bernie Sanders and Joe Lieberman, had 60 votes in the Senate. People who think that the Affordable Care Act should have looked differently than it did should realize what a knife edge that was. There were only 60 votes in the Senate at most. And the law passed by the slimmest of possible margins. You will recall that Scott Brown was elected in Massachusetts in January of 2010 before the conference committee could come up with a bill that put everyone forward. The only way Obama was able to move ahead with health reform was by holding the Democratic caucus and the independents together. And how did that happen? Well, previous to the Obama effort, there had been lots of discussions of health care reform, but they had tended to focus on means. How will we do this thing? Should we have a single-payer plan or a Bismarckian plan or managed competition or whatever? Instead, I think the Democratic caucus said, we're not going to worry so much about means. What we really care about is the end. The goal is coverage. We have some fiscal constraints we're putting on ourselves, but what we want to do is get to coverage. And we will make whatever compromises we have to make to get the votes, to get to coverage. Let's get too hung up on how. There are actually no two countries in the world who run healthcare the same way. We'll run it our own way. That's the way I think that in the end the Affordable Care Act got passed, and as I'm going to come to in a moment, one of the reasons that repeal is going to be very difficult. The law is very expansive. I'm just going to focus on a few pieces that are at risk today or are being discussed today. A lot of those are the pieces that took effect in 2014. the elimination of pre-existing condition exclusions, the elimination of underwriting, limits on how much more health insurance might cost older people than younger people, the elimination of gender rating. Now, if you did all of these things alone, they would encourage only older, sicker people to enroll in the marketplaces. Instead, the Affordable Care Act has a bunch of other provisions in it. One of them is risk adjustment. Private plans that sell coverage transfer money from those plans that enroll primarily healthy people to the plans that enroll primarily sick people. That encourages plans to enroll every kind of person. The law also incorporated in it a bunch of additional financial protections for insurance companies. Doesn't that seem strange? Why do you have to protect insurance companies from risk? Insurance companies are in the risk protection business. But actually, they were very nervous. And so the law includes sort of belt and suspenders provisions, what are called risk corridors and reinsurance, to protect insurance companies from mispricing. The law also required that all plans cover a set of essential health benefits. Instead of some plans including maternity and others not, all plans had to include the same benefits. Again, this means that people cannot select themselves into cheaper plans that don't have a lot of benefits, meaning that they're no longer pooling with people who need more protection. The plans also said, the law also said that cost sharing in the plans has to be standardized and that plans cannot limit how much benefit they provide. That seems weird. What do I mean plans cannot limit what benefits they provide? Before the Affordable Care Act passed, there were actually plans in effect. McDonald's sold a plan for $56 a month. If you bought this plan, you were eligible for $2,000 in healthcare benefits a year. Now, some of you work in hospitals. Does anybody here work in a hospital? How long does $2,000 last you? In 5 minutes, right? Well, the people at McDonald's who were buying these premiums did not realize that they were buying coverage that was really worthless. But the law says you can't have that kind of policy. You can only have policies that cover a reasonable amount of benefit. And then the law includes a lot of provisions to expand coverage. Young adults under the age of 26 get to be covered under their parents' health plans. I have to say this digression. My favorite moment in Washington was when my secretary sent me to address the 100th anniversary of Hadassah. So I went to the White House, to the auditorium in the White House, and it was filled with women, the Hadassah women, and I was telling them about Obamacare, and I asked them how many of them had a child who was covered under the provision that young adults under 26 got covered on their parents' health plan. I think 80% of the hands went up. I've never been so popular in my life. But unfortunately, there's both the strength and the weakness in that. This provision was great for upper-middle-income families who already had health insurance through their employers that they could put their young adults on. For low-income families who didn't have health insurance themselves, it didn't actually do any good. So the provisions that came into effect in 2014, tax credits to 400% of poverty. If you purchase an economical plan in your market, the amount you need to pay depends only on your income. The cost of the plan is irrelevant. They created these health insurance marketplaces. They expanded the Medicaid program based on income across all the states, although the Supreme Court rolled that back. But still, 30 states and the District of Columbia now cover under Medicaid anybody with an income under 138% of the poverty level. So 138% of the poverty level for a single adult is an income around $15,000 a year. So no matter why you're there, if you have an income under $15,000 a year, you're eligible for Medicaid. And then the requirements to offer and obtain coverage, the famous individual mandate. If you don't buy health insurance, if you don't join the pool with the sick, with the, if you hold yourself outside of the community, we might say on Pesach, then you have to pay this fine, the individual mandate, and the employer requirements. If we think about the four key challenges that I started with, the Affordable Care Act provisions really go a long way to bringing those 20% of people who were left out into the embrace of mechanisms that address the challenges. They provide risk pooling from the healthy to the sick because there's no underwriting. They provide subsidies for those with incomes below 400%, so no reason to leave the pool, no adverse selection spirals. They have an individual mandate. They have standardized benefits. They have risk adjustment. They transfer money from the rich to the poor. One of the reasons that the Affordable Care Act is not liked very much in certain conservative circles is because it's highly redistributional. It moves a lot of money from rich people to poor people. Medicaid at no cost, subsidies designed around income. And the subsidies are an entitlement program again. So if technology improves, there's more money in the system to provide it. And there's a lot of cost containment in the program as well. So what happened? Well, you probably remember that the website failed. Does everyone remember that? The first 2 months of the rollout were terrible, although it didn't make any difference because the coverage didn't take effect until January, and by December, the websites were working fine, at least at the federal level. In many states, the websites never worked at all. So there were some real problems with the websites, but at the federal level, it worked out okay. The share of the non-elderly adult population who were uninsured fell from 18% to 10%, which is the lowest rate ever in the United States. More people have health insurance than has ever existed. Roughly 23 million people were newly insured. I was raised in Canada. That's two-thirds of the population of Canada. For political reasons, unfortunately, it's only 7% of the population of the United States. So the people who were newly insured through the Affordable Care Act are not a big visible segment of the population. Uninsurance rates declined in every state, but especially those that accepted the Medicaid expansion. In some successful states, the uninsurance rates are down to 5%, which, given our extremely dynamic economy, is very, very low. There were substantial improvements in access to care. Premiums came in well below projections. The total cost of the plan was cheaper than anyone expected. The effect on national health spending was less than 2%, very small. That's all the good story. There were also problems. There were real problems in the marketplaces, especially in this last year. Part of the reason is that Congress failed to appropriate money for those belt and suspenders to keep the insurance companies happy. Remember I said you gotta protect those insurance companies against risk because they're really nervous? Congress appropriated only 13% of the money that had been promised to the insurance companies. They wound up losing much more money than they expected. Insurance companies made a mistake. They priced too low at the beginning. They thought the new exchanges were gonna be like Medicare. Once you got into them, you'd never leave. That wasn't the right way to think about it. This remains a very dynamic population. Young adults enter the marketplace, they get a job, they leave the marketplace. So pricing low to try and trap a lot of people and keep them in your plan wasn't a great strategy. So there were big premium increases in most places in the US for the 2017 enrollment year. Although even with those premium increases, the cost of the plan came in below projections. Large insurers exited marketplaces, so some have little competition, as was true before the plan passed. But there's really no evidence that the market is collapsing. The enrollment has been steady, even places with premiums rising. The final sort of blow that's kind of out there, the Damocles sword, is that there's a lawsuit pending. Congressional Republicans allege that some of the subsidies, those related to cost sharing, needed to be appropriated and that the administration used funds wrong. The lower court found in favor of Congress for the Republicans. If the court finding in favor of those Republicans is upheld, premiums will go up even more in the coming year and market instability will really rise. Okay, so there comes the Affordable Care Act, and just as it comes along, there's enormous political opposition. There are many different ideological positions about health insurance among Republicans. After all, Nixon was in favor of universal health insurance. George H.W. Bush put forward a plan that came to nearly universal health insurance. They have different ideas about what to do with market mechanisms and so on, but their aspirations towards universal coverage remain. Newt Gingrich, back in 1995, made a very clever political calculation. He said, Republicans should just oppose universal health insurance. It's just a bad idea for Republicans as a party, as a political proposition, not as an ideological proposition, not because we're fiscal conservatives, but because it's politically not a good idea. So he was able to use the Clinton health reform as an opportunity to galvanize political opposition to big government. It became sort of the picture of big government was Hillary Care. And that remained with a lot of, there's a lot of fervor around opposition to the Affordable Care Act. When Obama passed the Affordable Care Act, there weren't actually any Republicans who voted in favor of it. Why do I seem hesitant there? Well, one of the people who voted in favor of the Affordable Care Act was Arlen Specter. Arlen Specter was elected as a Republican, but he voted in favor of the Affordable Care Act. By the time he voted in favor of the Affordable Care Act, he had actually crossed the floor and become a Democrat. So he was, I don't know how you think about him. But he was the only vote by anybody elected as a Republican in favor of the Affordable Care Act. So as soon as the law passed and when Congress switched to Republican control, the Republicans in Congress began to pass laws to repeal Obamacare, repeal the Affordable Care Act. These were very easy votes. Nothing was gonna happen, Obama was president, so they could signal their tremendous opposition to the Affordable Care Act. And they began to do this before 2012, when most of the reforms were still not in place. So again, it was very cheap. You could say, I hate the Affordable Care Act. Nobody really knows what the Affordable Care Act, they didn't say they hate the Affordable Care Act. We hate Obamacare. something different. Nobody knows what it is. The uninsured churning population, they don't come and lobby for it because they don't even know who they are. Public are largely unaware of the benefits. So easy to repeal the law back in 2012. Donald Trump is elected. All of a sudden, this idea of repealing Obamacare becomes real, and Rabbi Adelman calls me. And the first thing the Republican Congress says is, we're gonna do this right away, and we're gonna do it using a mechanism called reconciliation. Because in the Senate, in the US Senate, you need 60 votes to pass a law, but you only need 50 votes if it's a budget bill. You could pass a budget bill in a process called reconciliation. So the initial plan was they're gonna do it in reconciliation, and they're gonna do it by January 27th. What day is it today? It's February 14th, nothing has happened. The two committees that were supposed to report out reconciliation bills haven't done it yet. What are the key elements that were supposed to be in those reconciliation bills? Change Medicaid to a block grant program, so we don't have an open-ended entitlement for care for the poor. They have more state flexibility. Eliminate the individual and employer mandates. Eliminate the non-group subsidies. All of that you could do in a reconciliation bill, but here's the trick. In a reconciliation bill, you can't change the regulations that govern the non-group market. You can't get away from those pre-existing condition exclusions, the way that prices, the plans have to be priced and so on. Now, that would have been fine in 2012 when the new marketplace regulations hadn't taken place. But now, if you don't change the rating rules and you take away the mandate and you take away the subsidies, we know what's gonna happen because it happened here in New York State. The individual market will just explode. If you say healthy people and sick people pay the same rates for coverage, there can't be any difference more than 3-to-1 between older and younger people, men and women pay the same premiums, the insurance market will explode if you don't have the subsidies in there and you don't have the individual mandate. It took Congress a little while to realize that, but then they did. Instead of talking about immediate repeal, they first moved to an idea called repeal and delay. Repeal and figure out what to do next. Problem with repeal and delay is that the insurance market is waiting for guidance from Congress about what to do for the next year. If you delay, what is the insurance market gonna do? So they said, okay, we're not gonna do repeal and delay, we're gonna do repeal and replace. But in order to replace it, you need 60 votes in the Senate, which means you need to get some Democrats to sign on. So from a political perspective, you're in a challenging place. What about the Medicaid expansion? There are 11 Republican governors who participated in the Medicaid expansion. They don't want the rug to be pulled out from underneath them and for them to have to deal with all of these people who will lose coverage. And then there are 25 million people who've gained health insurance coverage. Now remember that statistic I quoted at the beginning. 1% of the population gets sick every year and incurs heavy costs. Well, this is a big country. 25 million people is a lot of people. That means in 1 year of the Affordable Care Act, there were about 250,000 stories of people who got really, really sick and who were only able to pay their medical expenses because they got health insurance through Obamacare. Those 250,000 stories did not exist in 2012 when these repeal plans began to be talked about, but they're starting to show up at these town hall meetings, in newspaper reports, and so on. So it really galvanized the opposition that there are now tangible benefits. So what do the repeal proponents want? They don't have a consensus on where they're trying to go. There's no consensus on ends. Remember, I started off saying the Democrats agree on ends. They had arguments about means. The Republicans kind of agree on means, but they have arguments about ends. So means, health savings accounts, skin in the game, more competition across state lines. But nobody really knows where they want to wind up. They didn't really do much research on this area because they didn't know where they were going. So where things stand this evening, and by tomorrow morning, it's probably going to change. Today, the House Freedom Caucus said they either want a clean repeal or nothing, which means that probably they'll vote with the Democrats against any repeal because they won't get a clean repeal. The Senate Help Committee, which is the committee that Lamar Alexander chairs, says we need a replacement to go along with a repeal. Well, what would a replacement look like? Very vague ideas so far. I want to just give you a few of them and just remember that my four challenges. One is we replace the subsidies with a flat tax credit that is unrelated to income. That's in the Price plan. Representative Price, who's now the Secretary of Health and Human Services, put forward a plan that says people should get a flat tax credit. What does that do? No redistribution from the rich to the poor, no redistribution from the healthy to the sick, no protection against technological changes. Another idea is we get rid of individual mandate and go to something called continuation coverage. Well, that is also going to limit redistribution from the healthy to the sick, unless everyone's in the same plans. Another idea is let's get rid of those standardized benefits and let benefits be tailored to individual people. So, and this is the poster child, young men don't have to buy maternity coverage. Now, just for all of you who are worried about those young men buying maternity coverage, as soon as they get a job, they're paying for maternity coverage. So the only question is whether they have to buy maternity coverage only when they have a job, or they also should buy maternity coverage in the non-group market. If you don't require people to buy maternity coverage, that means that only women pay for the maternity coverage. And eventually, the market will lose maternity coverage in most plans. What should you look out for? Two imminent deadlines. That lawsuit over the cost-sharing subsidies, House of Representatives versus Burwell, the administration needs to file something by February 21st, 2017, next week. We have no idea what they're going to do. If they don't file something to hold back, to either put money in there for the cost-sharing subsidies or to fight that they're allowed to keep them, the insurance market will go into disarray. And then regulations need to be put forward to protect insurers in the market for 2018, and they have to file by April or May. So they can't delay this forever because that uncertainty in the insurance market will show up in the following year. So let me go back to Louis Ginsburg, because this is how Rabbi Andelman taught me you're supposed to do things. For most of us, the reason that we are most familiar with Louis Ginsburg is that in 1927, he composed the Prayer for the United States, which is read in conservative shuls on Shabbat morning. And I have a particular, peculiar fondness for this prayer. I know that's strange. But the 2 years that I spent in Washington while I was working for the Obama administration were also the 2 years before my son's bar mitzvah. And each week at shul, he would stand beside me and he would make sotto voce adjustments to the prayer. He would ask for a blessing for those who exercise just and rightful authority and add, and mommy too. And when he would expand on the list of good things that these leaders and advisors should do, from justice and fairness to health care for all. So as we enter into these challenging times that lie ahead, and I think it's going to be quite a complex spring, I'd like to invoke that prayer yet again and ask that Hashem grant wisdom to our leaders and advisors so that justice and fairness in healthcare and in other things continue to abide in our midst. Thank you very much.
Wow, thank you. All right, so we want to take a few minutes for questions. If you have a question, we want to invite you to come over to the microphone, which will allow the folks on the live stream to hear the questions as well. This is the time. All right, so I just want to remind you to phrase your question as a question and not go on too long so that we have more time to hear from our expert. Thanks.
State lines, that will help the problem. But I see that the morass of all these competing plans, and I think there's statistics that show that people actually didn't switch to better plans because of how confusing it was. But what do you think about more or less plans?
Okay, so I think you raised two really interesting points. One is, what's the optimal number of plans to have in a marketplace? Should it be one? Should it be a lot? I think there's probably a good argument for having a small number of competing plans, like three or four. 25 probably doesn't make that much sense. Three or four might make more sense. Keep them honest against one another. But that raises the question about state lines, which is a big piece of Republican orthodoxy, that if we just allowed insurance companies to sell coverage across state lines, things would be okay. Remember I said one of the challenges that the Republicans face right now is that they haven't been really thinking about what they want a health insurance plan to look like. They've been thinking for most of the last 8 years about what they didn't want a health insurance plan to look like, but they haven't had sort of a positive vision. And the idea of selling health insurance plans across state lines is what I like to call a Rip Van Winkle health policy. It's as if they had fallen asleep 20 years ago and only woke up now. Why do I say that? 20 years ago, most health insurance that was sold on an indemnity basis. You went to whatever doctor you wanted, you got a bill, and you sent it to your health insurance company. No health insurance exists that is sold in that form today. Everybody who has health insurance in which the insurance company contracts with a network of doctors and hospitals. And those are the doctors, that's your network that you can go see. If you buy insurance from a health insurance company in Delaware that provides you with a network of doctors and hospitals in Delaware, doesn't do you any good here in New York City. So it turns out that various states have allowed the sale of health insurance across state lines, and no insurers have entered those markets. So whether you like it or you don't like it, it just doesn't make any sense in the health insurance market today.
You spoke briefly at the beginning about the way the amount to which the cost of healthcare as a percentage of GDP has risen over the past 40 or 50 years. And you talked a little bit about cost containment in the mm-hmm. when discussing the different strategies for the different types of healthcare that exist in the United States. Can you talk a little bit more about the sort of the bigger picture of containing costs as a whole so it doesn't continue to balloon as a percentage of GDP?
Sure. So I want to actually distinguish between two ideas. One is containing costs at a point in time. We want to make our healthcare system run as efficiently as it possibly can, just like we want everything to run as efficiently as it possibly can. And there are many reasons to think it doesn't run that efficiently now, and the Affordable Care Act, as well as many other proposals, contain in them changes to payment methods, changes to payment levels that might lead the system to run more efficiently. It's a different question to ask what ought to happen to the share of GDP devoted to healthcare. And that's a question that I don't think has a very good answer. To put it in context, back when healthcare was only 4% of GDP, food constituted something like, I'm trying to get the numbers right, 14 or 15% of household spending. It's now down to like 5. So food has gotten a lot cheaper and healthcare has gotten a lot more expensive. Is that good or bad? It's nothing. Healthcare has gotten better, can do a lot of things today that it didn't used to be able to do before. If people want to buy it and they'd rather buy healthcare than other things, I don't think that's a problem in itself. When I read healthcare policy reports from back in the 1960s, people write things like, if healthcare ever exceeded 7% of the GDP, the economy of the United States would be shattered. And it's now 17% and we don't see anything. There's ample reason to believe we don't have an efficient healthcare system, that we spend far more than other countries do, we don't get as much out of it as we should. But all countries really face this problem of healthcare costs rising over time as healthcare gets better. And I don't think we should think of it as a problem so much as we should think of it as, well, we have to think of it as a problem, but it's a challenge that our healthcare system needs to address, but not necessarily something we want to cut off. If we could all live longer, healthier, happier lives, that would be a good thing, not a bad one.
My question is, which kind of healthcare policy result in better actual experience for patients with their doctors? And what I mean is, I was in a doctor's office, and he actually just described himself. He said, look, he was frustrated. There were tests that were needed. And I don't really practice medicine. I work for a health insurance company. And he was a Harvard graduate from the medical. So do you have any thoughts on that?
Sure. Actually, the interesting thought on that is that the doctors who are least unhappy are the ones who actually do work for health insurance companies. So one way to solve this problem is probably to have more staff model health maintenance organizations, where the doctors are the health insurance company, they run themselves, they figure out how they want to do things, they're not reporting to someone else. Most doctors don't like that idea because they don't want to be employed. But if they were employed, they probably wouldn't have to deal with half the paperwork they have to deal with. They could actually have a much better experience of practicing medicine. I didn't give this quote from Rambam, but he actually has a quote in which he says, doctors are always tortured by the need to make money and the need to practice medicine. And it remains a real consideration today. So The doctors who are most unhappy in the U.S., bizarrely enough, are orthopedic surgeons, who are the highest paid doctors in the U.S. I don't really understand that, but that's the way, maybe they're just unhappy people. We do observe real differences among doctors in job satisfaction, but a lot of it has to do with the circumstances of their practice. I will say, one of the things that we observe, and I don't know how to think about it really, is that the old style of a practice, a primary care doctor in a what we call a doc in a box, an individual doctor with his own or her own staff operating in an office somewhere on Central Park West and on the main floor of an apartment building, that probably just doesn't make any sense anymore. And the doctors who do practice that way are very unhappy, but it's because they are unhappy in the same way as people in other industries that have been, sort of like travel agents, that have been swept away by the tides of technology are unhappy.
Yeah. So does it suggest that, in effect, doctors sort of do need to become more like business people, or think of themselves as either employees or that's a little bit more the paradigm?
I think that is probably where we're going. If you look at systems, health systems in other countries, in many of them, not in all of them, you do observe more salaried physicians who are less likely to be practicing fee-for-service and having the sort of entrepreneurial physician model that we have in the United States. So I think that is probably the direction things are going. It will happen very gradually. I'm not saying it's a good direction or a bad direction. I think it's just an inevitable consequence of the fact that doctors' offices now have a lot more capital equipment, they have more technology, they are a bigger establishment. It's just harder to sustain that. The scale is not easy to do. If you only have one doctor there, probably just makes more sense to be operating in a salaried practice. We observe all these hospitals buying physician practices. I think that's a consequence of that too. It might be nicer the other way, but it might also be nicer if we had independent coffee shops instead of Starbucks.
Hi. Aside from the obvious difference of federal versus state level, how does the ACA compare to the main features of what then Governor Romney was able to institute in Massachusetts? Is there any possibility of replicating that on a national level or anything?
Oh,
like
sure.
That?
The person asking the question says Mitt Romney built something in Massachusetts that was essentially an individual mandate, subsidy based. Health insurance plan. The Affordable Care Act looks a great deal like it. It has a lot of other features. The Affordable Care Act has a lot more cost containment in it than Romney Care did, but for this purpose, I don't think it really makes any difference. I think it is important to know that Romney built that plan because both in a good way, a bad way, the federal government was giving him a lot of money to do that. So there was a carrot and a stick. He was about to lose a lot of money in his Medicaid program if he didn't do it. So there was a lot of federal money going into Romney's health plan. If the federal government turned around and gave the states comparable amounts of money, places like New York would probably do just what Massachusetts did. In fact, New York was almost on the brink of doing it before Obama was elected. I think it is much less likely that a place like Mississippi or Louisiana would be able to take those steps. They just may not have even the state health policy capacity to do it, aside from also being very poor. So a real challenge in going to a state-based model is whether all states could participate effectively. But to put that in context, Canada runs its healthcare system essentially in that way. We talk about Canada as having a single-payer health system. Actually, every province runs its own healthcare system with money from the federal government.
Hi. I have a kind of philosophical question. I don't quite understand the Republican support for employment-based health insurance. Why, as a pro-business environment, isn't the extra burden on business that shouldn't be there, and especially small and medium businesses have this huge extra burden to provide employment benefits?
I think on the whole, Republicans are not especially in favor of employer-sponsored health insurance. I think the challenge with employer-sponsored health insurance is that when you survey Americans, they love it. If you ask Americans where they would like to get their health insurance from, their number one choice is their job. So from a political perspective, it is hard to challenge that. To put that in context, Germany, until quite recently, and from 1883 on, had an employment-based health insurance system. So it's not as though it's kind of an American aberration. It was really the norm in most of the Bismarck model healthcare systems for a very long time. One can imagine moving away from it, but it would cause a lot of discombobulation, and people don't like change.
I just want to report that many years ago, I did a study in a large hospital center where I asked people how much money different people made and how much they should make. And I just want to report that not one physician knew how little the nurses' aides and the elevator operators got paid. One of the difficulties, I think, with our system is that in the 1930s, the American Medical Association actually said that medicine is a business like any other. This is quite contrary to traditional medical ethics. So we have that problem. We have another problem with our whole I call it capitalistic system. I want to tell a story. My grandmother told me a story many, many long years ago, or read it to me, out of a book of the fables of Aesop. There's two men walking along the beach, and they see an oyster. And then they start fighting about who saw it first. Another guy comes along, and they ask him to judge. And he says, very simple. He breaks open the oyster, gives each man one of the shells, and eats the oyster. I say, this is the situation of the health insurance and the medical industrial complex. They get the oyster, and neither the people who provide the care, nor the public, well, we get the shell. Well, let that be enough.
I think it's a good story, and I think it is a problem, but I don't know how to solve it.
So I guess recently we've been so focused in being concerned about the Affordable Care Act being repealed. I'm curious from your perspective, you know, if we can ignore that for a moment, what are some of the biggest challenges and perhaps, you know, changes and reforms to the legislation that we could hope for?
So if we wanted to improve the law, if you wanted to actually move forward and hold the law in its place, I think there are a couple of things that you would want to do. One is really thinking through this question of how to make sure there is choice, or what you're going to do if there is not choice in those insurance markets that are relatively sparse. So a problem in the United States is that it's not that hard to have competition in the New York City health insurance market. It's awfully hard to have competition in the rural North Dakota health insurance market. If you're not going to have competition and there's only going to be one health insurer there, how are you going to regulate, make sure that that health insurer doesn't take the oyster? Right? When you have multiple of them, you have some hope for competition. If there's only one, you can't rely on that. So what are we going to do? Are we going to have a public option? Are we going to have some other way of having options in those places where there isn't any? That's one. A second problem is that the subsidies, while relatively generous for people with incomes under about 200% of poverty, are not very generous above that level. And so there are a lot of people who are really not able to afford the coverage that is available under the Affordable Care Act, because their incomes are just a little bit too high. And we probably need to extend that coverage to provide a little bit more subsidy in that next tranche, to that next tranche of people. There are the 20 states that did not expand Medicaid, which is really terrible because there are people in those states who are very poor and have no access to health insurance. There are problems in the designs of the policies themselves, and this is a you know, a real health policy won't question, but there are a lot of people in health policy who think it's a great idea for people to have to pay a lot of their health expenses out of pocket, and that the best situation is one where people have these dedicated savings plans and have a lot of skin in the game and have to pay the first $5,000 of their health expenses out of pocket. There are other views on this, and my sense is that for a lot of people, those plans don't make a lot of sense. If you are interested in this, there's a really smart physician at Harvard, Ashish Jha, who, as an experiment, because he's been teaching this all his career, he enrolled himself and his family in a high-deductible health plan and has been complaining about it ever since on Twitter. So you can follow Ashish's tweets. But, you know, I think that it makes some sense for people to have to pay something at the point of service, and it's not clear to me that $5,000 is the right something. So we probably need to be thinking hard about the design of plans. There are also a whole bunch of little tweaks that you need to make around family affordability and other stuff like that. So there are ways to improve the plan. I think we are not going to, I think if we're fortunate, in my view, and now I'm speaking from my own personal perspective, we will just not do anything and just shore things up for the next 2 or 3 or 4 years, and then we'll see what happens after that.
Do you think we're approaching the time where we should stop referring to our healthcare system as insurance?
As opposed to what?
Healthcare system.
As opposed to a healthcare system?
Yeah.
Well, now I'm going to step, now I'm going to go.
Delivery.
So this is another big philosophical question. Most countries run what I would call a health insurance system. And the nature of a health insurance system is that the money and the rights and the decision making are primarily vested in the patient, in the individual. The person themselves, who has a policy and makes decisions about how to use it, and money flows with those decisions of that person. Do you see what I'm saying? There is an alternative design of a healthcare system. It's actually the design that most socialist countries used, the Soviet Union, Cuba. To a lesser extent, the British National Health Service did, but it has moved away from it, which is one in which the money flows to the institutions and the providers. People don't pay, they don't control the flow, they go wherever they can go, and the money flows to the institutions and the providers. My sense is that the first way works better, that actually funding the institutions and the providers puts resources, doesn't necessarily get resources where they need to be, and doesn't address the needs of people. It's probably what you would do if you were running a veterinary system, because dogs and cats don't get to make decisions for themselves, but people do. And my own view is that they should. So I myself prefer a health insurance system to a system that it just delivers, that just provides health care. But it's a challenging distinction to make.
You know, Price has said that the patient knows what they want, but the patient only knows what they can afford.
No, that's a different question. So I would like everybody to have enough coverage that they can afford the right selection of things. But from there, so there is a position, there is a compassionate conservative position that says we don't need to give health insurance to poor people. What we need to do is fund community health centers and safety net hospitals, so when they get sick, they can go to the community health center and they will be treated. That's in opposition to the idea that we give them health insurance or Medicaid. My preference is to give them Medicaid because the community health center can do whatever it likes. It can decide that being a community health center, what really matters is the color of paint on the walls or the staff or the how happy the nurses are, or whatever they might decide, which might not be at all what the patients want. So I prefer to put the resources in the hands of the patients and have them make the decisions, but there is definitely a position on the other side. Okay.
All right, so I think we'll draw it to a close because the hour is late. Thank you so much for that infusion of information and insight, and I think we are a much more informed audience for whatever is to come in the next few months and years. Thanks everyone for coming. We hope you'll join us again. Our next lecture is on March 16th. We'll be welcoming David Miliband of the International Rescue Committee to speak about the global refugee crisis. And following that, on March 27th, Abigail Pogrebin and Joseph Talushkin will be in dialogue here. We hope to see you again at JTS. Thanks so much again to Dr. Glied.